Greetings, I am Lady Guðrún, Sveinsdóttir of the Shire of Mountain Freehold in the East Kingdom, commonly referred to as Rosie. So I have been dancing in the modern sense since 2004 and in the SCA since 2012 or so. And I have taught both modern classes as well as SCA classes. I love the history as well as the dance and the music and the culture. So I am very excited to share all of this with you. I started off in tribal style, tribal fusion, and then some ATS American tribal style, but then when I had an opportunity to learn Egyptian style, I really, really connected with that. And so primarily what I do now is mostly Egyptian, although I dabble in other styles as well for fun. There are a great many styles available both in Egypt and outside of Egypt. In Egypt, there are 9 dance regions and a lot of folkloric dances, as well as what you think of as dance from a stage perspective. And that is true for many of the areas around the Middle East, as well as now across the world. So without further ado, let's get started and I'll give you a brief overview of what we're going to cover. Okay, so we are going to be talking about the history from ancient Egypt up to about just past 1600. I will also be covering a little bit of modern day, both mundane styles of dance as well as SCA styles of dance, because there are some differences. There are a lot of people who have learned in the SCA and not learned from the people of the cultures, and so there are definite differences. I'm not saying one's wrong, I'm saying difference. So we are going to talk a bit about how to be respectful of the cultures we're portraying in light of cultural appropriation, etc. as well. So let us get started. We will start with some of the different eras and areas that we are talking about, because dance is not homogeneous in the Middle East. There are many different cultures represented, many different styles of dance. There are folkloric dances, there are stage performance dances, and this is throughout history up to modern day. So let me see if I can share my screen. Okay, so what we are looking at right now is about 750 CE. The Umayyads are the biggest caliphate at this point. They are taking up the bulk of the Middle East, and you see we are talking the Levant, we are talking into Western Asia, the whole Gulf area, all the way across Northern Africa and part of Spain. So this is huge, a huge area. So the Umayyads are in power until about 750. And at that point, the Abbasids take over in the 9th century. In 750. In the 9th century, this is what we are looking at for the map. So 9th century, everything in green here is under direct control of the Abbasids. They are the ones who are in charge in this entire area, plus they are indirectly controlling the area to the east and the area to the west. They have now pushed the Umayyads all the way to Spain. So the Umayyads were in Spain, but they were everywhere else too, and then they just get pushed out of everywhere else just into Spain. And that's where they're controlling. Morocco, the Idrisids, are their own thing here. At one point, the Abbasids controlled it, but not for very long. They lost control of that fairly early. Okay, so we're now in the 9th century, going to 985. At this point, the Fatimids are in power in Egypt mostly, but then they control parts of northern Africa and parts of the Western Gulf. And then we see here the Byzantines are still happening up in the Turkish area, in southern Europe, that little bits to either side of the Mediterranean. And then there are these other states here. The Abbasids are still in the Gulf area and a bit up here as well. It's not saying that here, it's showing just the little states. But the Abbasids still are around, even though it doesn't show it. Let's see. Oh, and the Umayyads are still in Spain. So Andalusian, etc. Okay, so now you can see the Abbasids in 1200 have been pushed just to this one little green area, to the eastern Gulf here. The Ayyubids are now in charge of Egypt, and the Seljuk Turks are in charge of the majority of what used to be the Byzantine Empire, Sassanids, etc. Now we go all the way to 1260, where we get the Mamluks in Egypt. The Ikhanid kingdom, I don't know a whole bunch about, so we aren't going to talk about that much. But Seljuks are now in a very small area here. At this point, the Abbasids really are not in charge of pretty much anything anymore. So we've got little states here. At some point between the 900s and 1200s, there's a great, I can't remember what they call it, the Great Divide or the Great Fraction or something, but everything falls apart into little city-states. Okay, so now we get to 1510. So this is a big jump, but this is where most SCA dancers tend to congregate, because we have the most information about this area, or this era, I mean. The Safavids are now in charge, and a lot of SCA dancers love to do the Safavid Empire, which are the Persians. The Ottomans, again, dancers in the SCA love the Ottoman Empire as well. The Mamluks are still in charge in Egypt, and yes, SCA folk love that too. A lot of SCA dancers stick with the late period dance because of having a lot more material to base things off of, a lot more extant finds, a lot more research available, paintings, etc. So of course later period's going to have more, definitely. And then we get to 1550, you see that the Ottomans have really taken charge of a whole bunch of this area. The Safavids are kind of getting pushed out. There's this little place in the middle where it's kind of going back and forth between Safavid and Ottoman. And by 1683, I know that's past period, but that's okay. 1683, this is the Ottoman Empire. They've taken over a whole bunch. So you can see here the size of the Ottoman Empire in 1300 versus, you know, the different colors being different years, and the lightest colors you can see are a huge area that the Ottomans have taken over. Okay, so I am going to go back here to my not screen sharing. How do I stop share? Okay. And I am going to show you some pictures and go through the history a little bit. So we're going to back up We are going to back up to ancient Egypt because there is some really good figural representation of dance in ancient Egypt. I'm going to check and see, do we have any questions yet in the chat? No. Okay. So you can see that there are a lot of different eras and areas that we cover. So we'll just stick with ancient Egypt, and then we're going to go through the centuries and through the areas as we go along. Ooh, I'm running short on time. Okay. So let me share my screen again. Here we go. Maybe. All right. Everybody sees that? Perfect. Okay, so this is from the Tomb of Nebamun, and this is portraying some dancers in Egypt. Now, ancient Egypt, we know of four different styles of dance. One is going to be for celebrations, parties. There are also more, so at parties it's going to be performances for the most part by professionals. The celebrations, it's going to be everybody's dancing together, wedding processionals, everybody's dancing along the route. There are even wedding processionals today in Egypt where people are going from the house of the groom to the house of the bride, or to the reception hall, whatever they have decided. And there are a couple professionals leading the procession, but then there's a bunch of people singing and drumming and celebrating, dancing on the route. Okay, so that's the celebrations versus parties. There's also religious festivals, and then there are mourning dances, which we see as, let me turn to the side here, mostly any hieroglyphic representations or paintings are going to look like this. This is how the mourners would be posed. Okay, so one thing that's really interesting about seeing these kinds of representations is some of these movements look really familiar to anybody who knows much about modern Egyptian dance and other Middle Eastern dance. For instance, the hands of the dancer on the left, you can see they're up and they're together. Now, this looks to me a lot like the Middle Eastern snap, which, if you want to try it, you curl your hand three fingers around, your thumbs up, your first finger is out. The other hand, you put with the three fingers down, so you can curl it around the other three fingers. The thumb goes underneath the hand. This thumb comes over to brace, and then this finger is snapping against the other finger that is being held out. So it's the two first fingers that snap together. It's a challenge. It took me a while to learn from a wonderful Lebanese dancer, Shadia of Boston. So if you're near Boston, you might know Shadia. She's amazing. Okay, so that's what this looks like to me. I don't know if that's actually the case, but it seems plausible. You can see that there are musicians, and a couple of them seem to be clapping. One has a two-handed flute. We get a whole bunch of musical instruments from ancient Egypt. Unfortunately, I don't have any pictures of them, but we get frame drums, we get flutes, we have tambourines, we have harps. We can see all of these things in museums and in pictures online. I highly recommend looking it up because it's fascinating to see what kinds of instruments they would be using for the dancers. Okay, so, shoot, what happened? It went away. Okay, here's the next one. So, you may notice in the past one and this one, the dancers don't seem to be wearing much. We don't know whether this is actually what the dancers would be wearing or if this is artistic interpretation. If it's an artistic interpretation, it may be denoting a lower class. It could also be that the lower classes and acrobats and performers would be wearing very little. It's also very warm to be dancing and long skirts might get in the way. We don't know, but it's very interesting to see how most dancers are portrayed mostly naked. This one has a belt that looks a lot like coin belts of today. These two are wearing smaller belts and then the necklaces and headdresses. Okay, let's see if I can go to the next. Ah, if I move this, I can do that. Excellent. Okay, next one. This is tatib, which is, why does it say my screen sharing is paused? Can you still see my screen? No, you cannot. That is very strange. Okay, let me see if I can fix that. Resume. Here we go. Can you see it now? Yes, okay, good. I don't know why that happened. Technology is interesting. Ooh. That's very strange. People are, okay. Gotta love technology. All right, so let's get back. Everybody was able to see this picture though before? Yes, okay. So this is tatib. This was a fighting style. It has become a dance form as well. And this is mostly men who are doing this style. Nowadays, women will also do it, but it is traditionally a men's dance. So we can talk a little bit more about gendered dances and both historically and today. Okay, here's where we get into the religious festivals. This is the Apis Bull Festival, and this is a Roman bas-relief that is portraying Egyptian dancers. So you can see how some have arms up, their legs are bent as if they're coming down. And you can see in the left, it looks like there are some men with clackers. And now we skip a few centuries or millennia to the sixth or seventh century. This is Sassanid. And so this is another early Persian culture. And you can see here that the dancer is wearing a long skirt. Her arms are up. It looks like she's got a scarf behind. And her leg is kicked out behind her. This is a very common theme that we see in portrayals of dancers, is the leg kicked out behind and the scarf, especially in early period. And so she is wearing a long dress. The other dancer over here is not. She is not wearing anything except that scarf. And this is for a Bacchanid kind of festival, celebrating wine, celebrating fertility, etc. Okay. Now we get to the Umayyads. The Umayyads have some textiles. We do not know if this is a sheer fabric or if it's nothing, but either way, something showing through, and then they've got those scarves. And so this is again 700s, and it's most likely Umayyad. It may be Abbasid, and this one is in the Cleveland Museum of Art. The other one, by the way, if you want to know, is in the Freer Gallery in Washington, D.C. I had an opportunity to go there a couple years ago, so I actually took that picture. I'm very happy I was able to see it. This is a Byzantine dancer. Again, we see the leg kicked up behind, we see the scarf overhead, but of course she is in Byzantine dress, which means that which means that there's a shorter tunic and a longer skirt here. Now we get to 11th century. This is Fatimid, which is again in that Egypt area. And you can see how her dress is very textural. She's got a long scarf or hijab on, and she has what looks to be possibly a drum, maybe. It's hard to tell from the ivory or bone, whichever this is. But this is in the Museo Nazionale del Bargello, Florence, if anybody wants. This one is also in the Freer Gallery, and this is also Fatimid, and it is 12th century. So again, leg kicked out behind. This one looks like she's actually bending down, kneeling on the ground. And she's got the one hand up and the other hand on her hip. This is a really famous one. This is a reconstruction of an Abbasid wall painting. We actually have a description of Abbasid dancers. Unfortunately, I don't have it on me right now. I was trying to look for it and I just can't find where I put that. But it talks about how dancers should have certain qualities, both in their performance and in their look, their dress. So it says that dancers should have these long sideburns, low belts, large skirts, that they should have graceful movements, they should be very flexible, and these are all good qualities to have. They should know their movement choreography, they should know their techniques. He's talking about professionals. So we will talk in a moment about professional versus just regular people dancing, because there is a huge difference in how society views them and in how they are expected to perform. Okay, so this again is a wall painting from Dar al-Khalifa in Samarra, and the reconstruction of this painting is by Ernst Hertzfeld. Now we get into the Shaibanid period, and then we'll get to Safavid. So this is again from the Freer Gallery, and here's where we get into the princely gardens or the harem scenes. When we talk about harems, we are not talking about women completely cloistered away having to, you know, give their bodies to the Sultan all the time. This is not what harem originally meant. Harem, yes, where they're wives and slaves who were expected to please the Sultan? Yes, there were. But the harem was a larger group of people. So it included the king or caliph or sultan's mother, his sisters, his daughters. It included basically all of the women of the palace who were living as part of the royal family, including the slaves. And all of the children. So, of course, they would want to entertain themselves. How would they do that? Mostly dancing and music. There's a lot of that goes on there. So you can see here, one woman here has the castanets. I'm totally blanking on the name for them, but it's these two clackers or clappers. You can see that there is a harp and a tambourine here. And you can see that the tips of the women's fingers are hennaed, which is a fun thing here. Okay. Here a woman has scarves. This is getting into, this is the 1500s now, the Sassanids. And so you can see, again, a tambourine, a long lute-like instrument. It doesn't look to me like an oud is usually bigger, but it's interesting. I'm going to have to look that one up. You can see for the costuming at this point, it's a long undergown called a pirahan, and then there's a shorter sleeved but also long overgown, and they could be very ornamental. There are headdresses as well. A lot of women have these pearls underneath. There are also things that stick up to accent the front of the headdress. And you can see that her hands are hennaed. Henna is a big thing in these pictures. And this again, while the picture quality is not great, you can see that they're doing the snapping. And these ones have lace up rather than just open, because this is at this point 1560, so it's a little bit later. They've got what looks to me like a chanun, which is a stringed, it's kind of like a hammer dulcimer, except you pluck it rather than hammer it. And a harp and a tambourine. This one shows the ornamental costuming and the sleeve and the scarves that they would use for dancing. Oh, Kat, you just sat down on my computer. Sorry, I had a whole outline and the cat just erased it. Okay, well, we are gonna wing it. Okay, so the interesting thing about this one, this is from 1570. So this is women's clothing here with the lace up. This is men's clothing with the over tunic here. Who's dancing? Look carefully. This is not a female dancer. This is a male dancer, a boy, it looks like, from the size versus the size of the grown men, and he doesn't have a beard. Again, he has these clackers. So boys did dance. Usually they were professionals. And we will also get to that in a moment, because that is also a really fascinating topic. Again, here it looks like these are possibly boys dancing. So this is another outdoor garden scene. This one is fascinating because this does not represent humans. This is the Queen of Heaven and these angels feeding, bringing her food and drink and dancing for her, entertaining her. This is not your usual thought of, you know, how it should be very, you know, religious has to be serious. No, this is entertainment. So fascinating. And again, that was mid 16th century, Safavid. Again, Safavid, this one you can see a lot of them have longer sleeves. And we will see that also when we get to the Sufi. Many of the Sufi men dancers have longer sleeves. Okay, so this, again, a dancer is kneeling down, and another one looks like she's got the snap going on. We've got the chanun and a couple of tambourines. I wish I could find this in color. Unfortunately, I can only find it in black and white, but it's from the Brooklyn Museum. So that was all Persian. Now we get to Ottoman. So this is now Turkish, Ottoman. And this is a European portrayal from 1574 from the Bremen paintings that shows an Ottoman dancer. You can see how her dress is more fitted. The Persian ones were looser, but her dress is more fitted at the top and then it flares out at the bottom. So that is a big difference. Her lower arms are bare, which says to me, this may be a professional dancer rather than a higher class woman. Again, with the scarves, that was fairly common throughout the entire area. This is another one where you can see the dancer on the right, musicians on the left. This is another European portrayal of an Ottoman party. So now we get to the Sufis. This is another religious organization. And when sometimes we say dervish, dervish is the whirling, turning around for to get into a trance mode for religious purposes. And so I don't know where the goats come from. That is very strange to me. But the longer sleeves, and these are primarily men that do the Sufi dancing. You can see more of a frame drum, or a darbuki or dumbek style drum here, and the frame tambourine there. So, and this one is very late period. It's actually slightly after period, it's 1630. But I just love her veil. So you can see how things have changed since the 1500s here. The bust is a little more fitted here, but you still get the buttons or the button at the top and then the longer pirhan underneath and the low belt. Okay, so I'm going to stop sharing there. Okay, we fixed the screen share, good. So any questions so far about any of that? Because there's a lot of information about costuming there, there's a lot of information about movements. When we see static pictures, it's a little difficult to really get what they're doing unless you see modern day dancers doing things and are able to trace things back. So there is a lot of guesswork with it, but there's also a lot of good evidence towards certain movements being appropriate for our time period. Okay, anything else? Oh, we didn't get to talk about the boys dancing. So, professional dancers, usually lower class, sometimes slaves or servants, sometimes professionals. We have a contract from Greece that talks about how if this dancer goes to this man's party to dance for several days, I think it's a week, then she will get this many outfits, she will get this much in gold, this many donkeys to carry all of her outfits to the dance performance space and to carry them back. So there's this whole contract talking about how this dancer gets treated, which is fairly well, honestly. However, dancers are not high class, and therefore, you know, you don't let your daughter dance, you don't let your son marry a dancer, for the most part. This is not universal, but this is a fairly common theme throughout most periods in the Middle East. Even today, dance is not equated well, for the most part, with high society. Which is really frustrating to me as a dancer because it is so integral to the society, to the culture. Dancers need to be at weddings. Dancers, for tradition and for some very, very old fertility ritual type things, dancers are supposed to be at weddings. Dancers are supposed to entertain. So if you're not going to treat the dancers well, you know, that I don't like that. But I also understand from a cultural perspective, there are taboos and dancers break those taboos a lot. So one of the ways the dancers break taboos is there were boys in the Ottoman Empire in these entertainment families or professional troops called koçeks. And they would dress up in women's clothing to dance occasionally. Sometimes they were in men's clothing, but most of the time they were in women's clothing. And there were times when there is documentation of these dancers getting in trouble or having to leave an area for offering other services than dance. It is something that happened. Both the koçeks and the girl dancers. So there's definitely taboos that have been crossed there. We also want to talk about how the dancers across the ages do different things than what we think of as SCA dancing. So dance in the SCA, a lot of the dancers who have been dancing in the SCA for a long, long time have learned from one of two ways. One, they have learned American tribal style or other tribal styles that do come from America and therefore are doing the more tribal style rather than the Middle Eastern styles. There's also the dancers who do try to portray the actual cultures using dance moves and costuming or garb that is as much as can be from those eras and areas. So there are two camps of dancers in the SCA. And yes, there's some bleed for back and forth, but just to let you know, that's, if you haven't already experienced it, that is primarily the two groups one might fall into. The other thing that we should talk about is how cultures that have entertainment families and entertainment troupes have been treated, which is pretty badly. There is a word that I will only say once on here, which is gypsy. This is a word that a lot of people used for a lot of years. More modernly, we have come to realize that it usually is used as a pejorative term to certain cultures, historically speaking, and that a lot of people from the Romani cultures find it to be offensive. Therefore, a lot of dancers try not to use the term. Some dancers still do, and that's up to them, but I do not, because I don't want to offend the people who have been called that in a slur kind of way. Entertainment families and entertainment cultures, the Gawazi of Egypt, the Romani of Turkey and Hungary, there are these cultures that are traveling cultures, and a lot of times they have entertainment cultures or entertainment families that will go from place to place to perform. So again, they have not been treated well, but these families hold this history. The Gawazi, and by the way, Gawazi coats, not period. Fun, not period. It's up to you if you want to wear one, but just to let you know, it's much later. The first time we see it is in the 1700s, 18th century. So a couple hundred years too late for the SCA, but that's okay. They're fun and they look pretty. So the Gawazi culture, we still see in Egypt today, Gawazi dance. And these dancers were the ones who were dancing in the streets originally in Cairo. And the Awalim were in the homes. They would be professional dancers that would go into somebody's home for a party. So there was a difference in how they were viewed. The Awalim were viewed higher than the Gawazi, since the Gawazi were out on the street. But then they all got kicked out of Cairo. And then when they came back, they were just all Gawazi at that point, pretty much. There are famous dancers from Egypt that would not say that they were Gawazi because of the stigma. So anyway, that is a lot of history in a short amount of time. I could go on and on, but I know that we have run out of time for the history and we need to go to the dancing. Any questions before we do that? Nope. Okay, excellent. So I am going to relocate this computer. I'm going to show you my Abbasid outfit. This is 10th century long dress. It's, hold on, let me get this out of the way. Long dress, long skirt. Let me see if I can show you the skirt. It helps if I take this slippers off. So this is going to be where you can see that pose that we see in the dancers. It's very common to have tiraz bands. So it attaches, it's got a slit. This is a smaller slit because it is 10th century. Sorry about the quality here. I need to figure that out. And then this would be the type of hat that we saw in the Samara thing. However, it's really hard to dance with this on and actually show you, it's easy to dance with it on, but it's hard to show you the movements while wearing it. So if you'll pardon me for just a second, I will be right back. Now is a good time, if you brought a scarf to put around your hips, to go find that and get a drink of water. I'll be right back. All right. So, different eras would put this at different levels. So just different cultures, different areas. So Morocco, you're gonna be all the way down here, pretty much at the widest center of your hips so that you can showcase the movements that they have there. If you are in Persia, nowadays it's probably up here. In period, it's probably down here. Egyptian, we are going to be pretty much down here. So that all, it depends what you're trying to accentuate and what movements you are doing. So if you're going to be doing a lot of hip movements, it makes sense to have a belt that is going to show the hip, how the hips move. Okay, I am going to attempt to put on some music for us. So hopefully everybody's had some water and are ready to dance. If you have any trouble with any of these moves, please don't do them. It really depends on everybody's physical needs. So we want to make sure that whatever you are doing is healthy and comfortable for you. So, first thing is we want to warm up. Breathing is important. So let me come back here. Can you still hear me? Yes? Okay, excellent. So we are going to, as we breathe in, we are going to bring our arms up. As we breathe out, we're going to bring them down. Okay, so take a deep breath in. And out. And you're letting your knees come down, just loosening up. And come over to one side. So you're stretching the side body. And bring it up to the other side. And again to the first side. So one thing we're going to want to make sure is that our body positioning is comfortable and safe. So we are not going to want to arch our backs too much. We're also not going to want to over tuck because that's not great for the spine either. So what we want to do, and let me move this to the other side so you can actually see it. What we want to do is kind of bring up and in from the ab muscles, and when we do that, it's kind of like we're about to sit down. So we are slightly curling under by bringing it up. And our feet should be planted firmly on the floor. How's that feel to everybody? Good? Excellent. So if you feel like you lose this at any point, just come back to it, and then you can go on. I just want to make sure everybody is in a safe, comfortable position. Okay, so we are going to do some hip ups and some hip downs. And how we do that is primarily through the knees. So knee straightens, it brings it up. Knee bends, it brings it down. So we are going to straighten one knee, but keep the other one bent. That makes this hip go up. Just let that knee go back to neutral. Bring the other one up,
Neutral. Up. Neutral. Up. Neutral. And just keep alternating this slowly until you feel like it's comfortable. And then we're going to double time it. So we're going to get rid of that neutral point in the middle. So up, 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 up. And there can be a little reverberation if you just keep everything loose. If you tighten it up, it's going to be a lot smaller. If you let it just reverberate and be loose, it's a lot more comfortable. Okay, let's double time it. One, two, three, four. And you can bring your arms up for balance if you'd like. Just make sure that when you bring them up, they are relaxed. So it's kind of like there's a drawbridge in the back. So as the lever of the drawbridge goes down, the arm just floats up. All right, let's double time it again. One, two, one, two, one, two. Good. All right, can you double time it again? One, two, three, four, one, two, three, four. This is a shimmy. All right, let it relax. So once you get it faster and faster, it becomes a shimmy from the knees. We don't always have to do a shimmy from the knees. There are other types of shimmies. So this is based from the hips, and it's a much smaller one. So it's basically a vibration there. There's also the side-to-side one. So there's a big parade going on outside right now. I apologize for that. It happens pretty much every night for the first responders and medical personnel. And so it may be loud for a minute. Okay, so this is, you are twisting the hips. So when you twist forward, we're not twisting the entire body with it. We are keeping the shoulders straight and just bringing that hip as if you're going to cross over, but not. So you're bringing it forward on a horizontal plane. And then as that comes back, the other one comes forward. So feet stay, shoulders stay. It's the middle of the body that is twisting. And if you do this a little bit faster, it looks like this. One, two, one, two, one, two. And then you can do it faster, and it becomes a shimmy. And this one is used primarily if you're doing some kind of movement where you're stepping forward and want to accentuate it with a little shimmy, or stepping backwards and want to accentuate it with a little shimmy. It is not usually done for a long period of time. I mean, it can be, but you're usually moving, doing something else with it when you are doing this movement. Okay, so we have done this shimmy, we have done this shimmy. There are two other shimmies in Egyptian dance that are a lot of fun. So the first one is the Elvis move. So you know how Elvis did the back and forth? This is basically tucking the hips and releasing. So we pull up in front, release, pull up, release, pull up, release. So it comes forward and back, and that becomes a shimmy. Again, that's a lot harder to do for a long period of time. It's definitely more a little accent piece. And then the fourth one, which I'm just going to, you come up on your tiptoes, and it's your heels that are coming down. So your heels are bouncing, and when they bounce, you come down with them. So, one, two, and then up. One, two, down. Good, that looks good. All right, so those are the four types of shimmies in Egyptian dance. We are going to talk about some arms now, and arms are kind of more present in Persian dance than in Egyptian dance. Arms are big in Egyptian dance, but they're not as big as in Persian dance. Persian dance is primarily arm movements nowadays. We believe that a lot of modern Persian dance is based on the court dances of the Safavid period, but there's a lot of conjecture that happens because a lot of Persian dance has, not been allowed to happen in Persia, in Iran, recently, and therefore a lot of the dance died out and is having to be reconstructed. So that's where we get modern day Persian dance, is the reconstruction. Thank you. I have my water bearer over here. Thanks. That works. Thank you. Okay. Persian dance. We see these scarves. So these are just to make the arm movements look bigger. There are movements you can do. You can have them be the focus, or you can just do whatever arms you would normally do, and the scarves are an afterthought. So that's scarves. But we'll just talk about arms for now, because I didn't ask people to bring scarves. So arms, again, we are floating them up. In Persian dance, there's a lot of kinds of poses, and it goes along with usually a 10-8 meter semi. But we will bring one arm out and the other arm crosses, and it's kind of a, as if you're laying something down, but it doesn't go down that far. So bring them up and down, and then sweep them across and down, sweep them across, down. So that Persian moves, arm moves are very elegant. So here's another one that we can do, which is there's a lot of this kind of movement of accentuating the eye, and then accentuating the eye. So this is another Persian one. So I'm going to contrast that with Egyptian arms. So Egyptian arms are more big movements. So you're framing the face. So one hand is back behind the head, the other one is out, and you're just letting the arm float out there. And then you can switch. So the other one is out. Back, switch, switch, switch. Good. You can also do something that's around the head, so. But that one is not as common. There's also, if you get into a faster beat, you can bring your finger to your forehead or out, and this is just, hey, I'm having a great time. I am dancing. I love this. It's a lot of fun to just go along with the beat, dancing like that. Okay, so those are some common. We also have this kind of movement in American tribal style and tribal fusion, which I think comes from this kind of move, but it's more like pulling taffy is how I first learned it. Okay, so those are some different styles of arm movements. So we have the hips going back and forth for those different shimmies. We've got some arm movements. If we want to get into American again, this is snake arms. So it's bringing it from the shoulder, through the elbow, through wrist, through fingers. So everything, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, and it's just back and forth undulating the arms. And that is a very common one. Let's see, we have some head movements. We haven't done head movements yet. So what we want to do with the head, we can bring it back and forth. When we do that, we want to warm up the neck first. So let's stick the neck out and bring it back. And this is all horizontal motion. We can then stick it out to the side. Again, horizontal, stick it out to the other side. Side, 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 side. Bring it around in a circle. So front, side, back, side, front, side, back, side. So we are just going to smooth that out. So front, side, back, side. And we can make that a smaller movement. And then we can switch it to the other side. So side, front, side, back, side, front, side, back. And then smoothing it out. I know I'm going through a lot of these fairly fast. Stop me if you need anything. Okay, so that is head movement. So you can do something like that. Or you can bring it up, which again is a little accent. It's not happening the entire time you're dancing, but it's a lot of fun to just get into the music that way. Okay, so we talked about arms, we talked about neck, we talked about hips. Let's talk about shoulders and ribs. So shoulders, we can bring the shoulders front and back and create a shoulder shimmy that way. So bring one to the front, then let it go neutral. The other to the front, let it go neutral. Front, neutral. Front, neutral. Then take out that neutral portion to do just front, 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 front. And this is just the shoulder that's moving forward and back. Notice that the arm is staying fairly still. And this takes some practice, so don't worry if you don't get it right away. All right, let's speed that up. 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2. See if you can speed it up again. 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2. So you'll notice that it does make the ribs move a bit. But that's not the focus here. The focus is the shoulders. All right, let it relax. Shake it out a little bit. Because I know that one can be a little intense on the shoulders. Ribs. Ribs can slide back and forth. They can slide front and back. They can slide around. So we are going to bring the ribs forward and back. Forward, back, forward, back, forward, back. And then we're going to bring them side. And again, this is a horizontal plane. So a lot of these movements require separation. once we put the moves all together, it becomes seamless. But in the meantime, we have to think about those separations between the body areas and the movements. Okay, so let's bring it forward, side, back, side, forward, side, back, side, forward, side, back, side. Now double time forward, side, back, side, forward, side, back, side, forward, side, back, side. Double time again. Back, side, forward, side, back, side, forward, side, back, side, forward, side, back, side. And smooth it out. Forward, side, back, side. All right, now let's switch directions. So forward, side, back, side, forward, side, back, side, forward, side, back, side, forward, side, back, side. Smooth it out. Good. All right, shake it. You can also bring it up and down. So you can bring it in an arc over to one side, or you can just lift, drop, lift, drop. So what we're doing here is we're just lifting and dropping. It's not forward, back, it's lift, drop, lift, drop, lift, drop. And so when it becomes fun is when we bring it to the side, then we lift and bring it to the other side and drop. Lift, drop, lift, drop. So you're making a semicircle with your ribs. Drop, lift, drop. And you can do it downwards as well. So drop, lift, drop, lift, drop, lift, drop, lift, drop, lift, drop, lift, two more, and then let's bring it in a circle. So lift, drop, drop, lift, drop, drop, lift. This is, I find, a good stretch for the back, because it moves everything around, because you are supporting from the back as well as moving the front. All right, let's switch directions. So lift, drop, drop, lift, drop, drop. Good. So now we can go around and around. Horizontally and vertically. Okay, so, and we can make the ribs also go back and forth. So we can do a shimmy, which is back and forth twist. So it's twisting the ribs front, twisting the ribs front. So again, shoulders stay in place, hips stay in place now. It's just rib area that is going to be going back and forth. So, it's a lot harder to do slow than it is to do fast, to be honest. I can't do it that way because then you can't see, but it's basically just a fluctuation. It is very fast. Okay. All right, back to hips, because we have done up and downs. We have not done arounds. So, oh, we did ups. We didn't really go down. So the down portion, instead of going up, you're going lower. So you are bending the knee lower. So let's do that first, and then we can do a round. So, down, back to neutral. 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 Down, 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 down. So you can see how it's a similar motion to the ups, but it is focused down and grounding. Double time, down, 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 down. And double time, down, 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 down. This one doesn't usually turn into a shimmy. It's usually the ups turn into a shimmy, the downs are more for accents for walking, etc. That this is more modern, but Sofiazaki was famous for a kind of hip down where she's on her toes and her legs are pretty much straight, but she's going down as she's walking. So those are called Sofiazaki hips. It's fun. It's kind of prancing, but very different focus than the ups. Okay, so we also want to go around. If you slide your hips forward, then notice that it's not bending, it's sliding them. So slide forward, slide to the side, slide it back, slide to the side. Forward, side. Back, side, forward, side, back, side, forward, side, back, side. And now let's smooth that out. So forward, side, back, side. And today in Egypt, you'll bring your arms in when you're going back and out when you're going front. I do not know about in period. It's, again, a lot harder to tell when we don't have that much information about 10th century Abbasid or Fatimid. Okay, so let's go the other direction. So forward, slide, back, side. Smooth it out. Now, moving this way is definitely an Egyptian thing. Persian is a little different. Of course, Turkish again is going to be different. But this is the Egyptian circle. So, you got both directions. We can also do figure eights. So how we do figure eights is we go down, slide out to the side, up, slide back in to neutral. But when we come up, the other one is now down. So then it comes out. And when we slide that one up, this one is now down. Out, up, down, out, up, down, out, up, down, out, up, up, up. So this becomes that figure eight. And this is horizontal, or this is vertical only. So there are other figure eights that are horizontal. This is just the vertical one. So this one is commonly referred to as a taksim. Taksim also is part of music, so that can be confusing. Okay, we can also do the opposite direction. So we're coming up, out, down, up, out, down. This one is referred to as the Maya a lot of times because Jamila Salimpour in California actually learned this by watching an Egyptian dancer named Maya back at the Fez in the 70s. So this again is so up, out, down, up, out, down. This one I think is a little too fast for us right now. Let's do that. Okay. So down. And this one is fun to walk with. The other one, tuxing, can be fun to walk backwards. So let's do the horizontal ones. So when we're doing the horizontal ones, we already did this. We're just twisting back, scooping around to the front, sliding. So this one is now to the back. Slide. Slide. Around. Slide. Around. Slide. Okay, so we can also do that the other direction. So we can do it to the front, around to the back, front, around to the back. So slide forward, around, forward, around, forward, around, forward, around. All right, let those hips. I noticed that we only have 5 minutes left. So does everybody want to do a little bit of improv with what we have already learned, or do we want to learn some more moves? Improv? Okay. All right. So this is a good one for some more upbeat music. So let's start with the hip hops. One, two, one, two. And you can bring your arm up. One, two, one, two, one, two, one, two, two, two. And switch it to the side. All right, let's switch to some of those horizontal figure eights. One, two. You can bring your arms around and down as well. So this is a very common one. For the arms to go across and down. If you can do both at the same time, that's okay. You could just focus on the hips, or just focus on the arms. Let's do that arm movement. And let's do that while trying to shimmy. And, oh, we didn't do undulation, sorry. Let's do some hip circles. And that around to the back, twist, around to the back, twist. Twist. And walking with the shimmy if you can. And back with the tuxedo. Forward with the Maya. And do the head. That's the song. And it is 7:28. We've got 2 minutes. Anything else last minute that you want to learn? We didn't do undulations or traveling steps. I can just show you those really quickly if you'd like. Yeah, okay. So undulations, what we want to do with undulations. There are top undulations, there are lower undulations, there are undulations that work both together. So the most common one is going to look like this. And how we do that is the chest comes, swoops up and back, up and back. And while it is doing that, the hips are back while the chest is up. And then you ground the hips down while the chest is coming back. So chest, hips. So when we break that down, we are scooping the leg. So it's down, out, and down. So we are switching between the two, the legs, which one has weight. So the front one comes, has the weight first while we're scooping up. And then as we come back and give the other leg the weight, that's when we're scooping in. So back, or forward, back. And then when we bring the top into it, it becomes kind of a wave for the whole body. And then traveling movements. There are some really fun ones. One is the grapevine. So you're going to cross leg, put the other leg out, then cross behind, put it out, cross in front, put it out, and then you can go back. So cross the other leg in front, stick the other leg out, back, out. And you kind of bend your legs usually when you're doing this in line dancing. You don't have to if you're going across a stage or something, you're not going to do that. But if you're doing a line dance, it usually is more bouncy. So that is a common one. You can also do 1, 2, 3, and then sweep the leg out. That's a very common one. When you sweep, it is making a half circle with the leg. So bringing it from back to front. So it's 1, 2, 3, out. Let me do that back so you can see it. 1, 2, 3, out. It's hard to show in a small living room.
All right, anything else? Oh, we are 2 minutes over time. Okay, I am going to stop the recording, but if anybody else has any other questions, feel free to ask them after I stop recording.